to play football. Football needs special equipment. A college covered with ivy, a coliseum or stadium filled to overflowing with 100,000 rabid, wildly cheering fans, great armies of vendors, managers, mascots, photographers, sports writers, doctors, elaborate brass bands, assorted coaches, old grads, scores of Annie Oakleys, and two teams resplendent in brilliant uniforms create a riot of color and atmosphere unequaled by any other game on earth. Now, the object of the game is to advance the ball over the goal line of the opposing team by hook or crook. There are 11 men on either team, two ends, and that's how the game is played. Now the teams line up for the kickoff, the referee blows his whistle, and the game is on. It's a long, high, end-over-end kick over the end zone into the arms of Swivel Hip Smith, that great All-American star, triple threat scat back. Look at him go. They can't touch him. He can really carry the mail, that boy. Look at that open field running. Look at that straight arm. He's away, and he's over for a touchdown. Well, it isn't often you see this happen. 105 yards to a touchdown on the opening kickoff. Now here's the try for the extra point. And the kick is good. And the score is 7-0. Here comes Swivel Hip Smith out of the game. Listen to that cheer. The coach is saving Smith. He's not taking any chances with his star player. Back to the game. Taxidermy Tech kicks off to Anthropology A&M. But the ball is fumbled, yes, and now it's Taxidermy Tech's ball. They go into a huddle. The quarterback or field general looks over the defense and decides which number to call. They come quickly out of the huddle. The line shifts into position. The quarterback barks his signals. The backfield shifts. The ball is snapped. The quarterback fakes it to the halfback, gives it to the fullback. The front pile drives through center for a gain of 8 yards. And that quarterback's a smart boy.
Whoa! All right, signals. 18, 29, 47, 63, 54, 99.
The team's working like a well-oiled machine. Double wing back to the right from an unbalanced line. A man in motion. The halfback's got it off tackle, and he's smeared for a 9-yard loss. What a dumb quarterback. To the spectator, football may appear rather rough at times, but in reality, it's a character-building game. All right, taxidermy's ball. Third down and 11 to go. DeGrotti has the ball. He gives it to Gershman. No, Sibley's got it. There it goes to right. No, no, it's a fake. A hidden ball. Crisscross, cross buck, end around, double lateral, razzle dazzle, spinner, split buck. And he's in the clear. Uh-oh, there's a penalty on the play. It's against Taxidermy Tech. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 15 yards for unnecessary roughness. Now it's fourth down and 26 to go for TNT. The quarterback is worried. The coach radiates confidence. The quarterback decides to kick. It's blocked. No, he got it away. It's a high spiral. The safety man's under it. He muffed it. It's a loose ball. Number 48's in fast. Oops! Butterfingers. Moose Williams got it. He had it. Now DeGrotti missed it. Sebring boots it to the 50. There it goes to the 35. It's next ball. No, wow! Right wrenched it away, and it's A&M's. No, everybody dropped it. Nobody's got it. 100-yard fumble, a free ball over Tech's goal line, but here comes Nordberg. He's recovering the old pork skin for a 6. What a play. The teams line up for the try for the extra point. There's the kick, and it's blocked. Anthropology A&M receives, and they're nailed on the 25-yard strike. What's the quarterback going to call? It looks like a pass. It is a pass. Geronimy fades back, cocks his arm, rifles a bullet pass into the flat. It's intercepted by Anthropology. Here's the 40-yard marker, the 30, the 20, the 10, and he's over for a touchdown. There's the try for the extra point. It's good, or is it? Yes, no, yes, no, yes, no, and there's the gun ending the half. Well, here's one for the books. The officials put their heads together, they reach their decision, and the score at the end of the half, Taxidermy 7, Anthropology 12 and 1 half.
T-A-X-I-D-E-R-M-Y. T-A-X-I-D-E-R-M-Y. T-A-X-I-D-E-R-M-Y.
During the half, the players are allowed to relax. The coach, who is a master of psychology, points out their weaknesses. To prevent overconfidence, he shames them. Arouses their school spirit. A man of many moods, now threatening, now pleading. A saint. A devil. He has varied and subtle ways of appealing to their sympathy.
Now get out there and fight!
Back on the field, the second half's about to start. Smith's going in. Listen to that cheer. There's the kick. Swivel Hips is under it. A host of anthropologists close in, but he breaks away. 10, 20, 30. Look at him go. 40, 50. They can't stop him. Listen to that crowd. 60, 70, 80. Look at that straight arm. He's in the clear. 90, 95, and he's over for a... Wow! He's hit and hit hard. This is a real blow to the coach. They're taking Smith out. It's a tough break for the team. They're working on Swivel Hip Smith. Tech is snowed under by a wave of tackle. The coach is feverishly trying to revive Smith. Time is running out, and taxidermy is up against a stone wall. Desperately, they work an old swivel, only time for one more play. Look at Smith on his feet. He's going in. The crowd goes wild. Anything can happen. The team's fired up. Here's the play. Smith's got the ball. He's away. Look at that blocking. Smith reverses the field. They're clearing the way. Not a man on his feet. Smith cuts back. The crowd is hysterical. It's Smith, tight roping down the sideline. Smith breaks into the clear, but look, there's an anthropology man on his feet. 1 second to go. What a game, and here comes the tackler. Run, Smith, run! Smith's tired, having trouble with the ball. The A&M man is gaining. He leaves his feet. Look out, look! There's the final gun, and Smith wins for Taxidermy Tech by half a point. To the coach goes the real credit. It's his clear thinking and calm, level-headed reasoning that makes football the great game it is today.
City offers a wealth of opportunities for a good private detective. The requirements for such a job are quite simple. Item number one, he needs office space. Item number two, a client. A classy dame with a problem.
Well, howdy, ma'am.
Find Al.
Sure, I'll find Al. Oh boy, 100 smackaroos.
Item number three, he needs a working agreement with homicide.
Al, who?
Now listen, you leave this Al case to the police. Understand?
And last but not least, a shady or suspicious character.
Huh?
Hey, Seamus, toss me your heater. Nah, stupid, your rod, your gat, your gun.
But a smart dick knows how to handle a cheap hood.
Eyeball, you know too much about Al.
A private eye knows how to dish it out.
Oh, yeah? Well, take this.
And how to take it. Ever alert. He follows every lead.
I told you to drop this case, Eyeball.
Well, how did you know it was me?
Has a photographic eye and never forgets a face.
Say, do you know Al?
Don't hear you.
I'll give you a dollar.
I hear you now. This one's on the house. Did you say Al?
I know that face. I think. Looks like I'm getting to the bottom of this case. Thank you.
told you to let the police handle this Al case.
Obviously, the next step is to check the Chronicle's files and get all the information on Al.
Now, where have I seen that face before?
Beat it! And don't come back till you're ready.
A smart operator always keeps in close contact with the police.
Beat it. I'm busy.
You leave this Al case to the police.
A check with the underworld brings quick results.
Follow that car!
Yeah, follow that car!
Follow that car!
That proves that crime don't pay.
Man was born hungry. From this early desire, he developed a taste for food. Eating became a habit. With the inner man satisfied, he is filled with a sense of well-being.
Ah. Hello, handsome.
Hello, fat.
Who's fat?
Who? You.
Why, I'm as fit as a fiddle.
A bass fiddle.
Yeah? Well, get a load of that, Mac. What a runner. Terrific at tennis, triple threat in football, record-breaking jumper, and boxing. Clever, fast, hard-hitting.
Easy does it, Fatty.
I was an all-around athlete.
That's right. Only now you're just all-round. You're going to pot. You're getting too big for your britches.
Oh, it's just an old suit.
Well, well, off with the old, on with the new. Stripes are slenderizing. No one can call you fat.
We're too fat.
Although you're a heavy eater.
Any more grub, Chub?
You always settle for a light lunch.
Going up? You're just too fat. Fat?
Who's he calling fat? You are jolly, genial, lovable, and fat as a pig. I must be getting fat.
What you got there, Fat? Bring it here, Junior. Here's an easy one. Let's see you touch your toes.
Toes?
If you can't see them, you can't touch them. Let's face it, Chubby. Your trouble is eating.
Eating?
It says here, quote, eating and overweight go hand in hand. Hey, Fat!
Huh?
You can't eat all that. No bread, gravy, beans, potatoes, pie, cake, cream, sugar, spaghetti, butter, starch. Just good old substantial low-calorie food. But better yet, firmly place the hands on the table and push. That's better. Get thee behind me, salami. Attaboy, Slats. I knew you could do it. No munching between meals.
Eat. Eat. Eat.
Relax. Eat. Food, forget. Try a new hobby. Read a book.
Yeah. Eat. Tender ham.
Eat.
Delicious pies.
Eat.
Mashed potatoes.
Eat.
Candied yams.
Eat.
Fried chicken.
Eat.
Melted butter.
Eat.
Whipped cream.
Eat.
Spaghetti.
Eat.
Macaroni.
Eat.
Cake. Ice
Eat.
Cream.
Eat. Eat.
Luscious grapes.
Eat.
Bananas.
Eat. Eat.
Cold cuts.
Eat.
Trout, golden brown.
Eat.
French pastry, a la mode.
Eat.
Cream puffs.
Eat.
Ham and eggs.
The carrier of the common cold is a tiny virus, easily identified by his red nose. Although the virus wins few friends, he influences many people. Sometimes the average man seems to deliberately try to catch cold.
Goofe! Take that cold out of here!
But boss, look, I don't have a cold. Achoo!
Now look, Goofe. A cold is nothing to be sneezed at. Beat it!
Poor Goofe, an outcast from society, shunned by a cruel, cold world.
Hello? I feel awful. Where is everybody? Huddy, Clay, Bridget, Mabel's. Dinner in icebox. Deserted!
Deserted by the ones he loves the most in his hour of need. Alone with his misery. A definite change has come over this man. He doesn't even look like himself. The top of his head feels like it's blowing up. He feels awful. But man has always been a fighter.
I don't feel good.
Am I ever glad to be home? My, what a day.
I'm sick.
Ooh, my feet are just simply killing me. There. That's better.
I've got a cold.
That nosy Mrs. Ripsnoop. Did I ever give her the cold shoulder? She tried to tell me how I should follow suit. I'll bet you'd have enjoyed the game, the second rubber in particular.
I drew the ace, queen, and a beautiful run of hearts. Loveliest hand I've ever filled.
And you know the prize is some silly
mini thing. Heaven knows what I'll do with it. Well. But anyway, George. George, are you listening?
Huh?
I'll bet you haven't heard a single solitary word I've been saying.
Choo!
What on earth's the matter with you?
I got a cold.
A what? Oh, you poor boy. Well, don't stand there like an idiot. Close that window. Bundled up. Get off that cold floor. Jump into bed. Mama's little man don't feel so good. Well, we'll take care of that. We'll break that old cold. Mustn't get chilled. Say ah. You look feverish. Probably just getting a cold. Keep covered up. Nice warm mustard plaster, just the thing. It's all in your head. Now some nose drops. There, feel any relief? Kind of woozy? This should do it. Ah, sleeping like a baby.
So, 2 weeks later, Mr. Geef's cold had run its natural course. And once again, Mr. Geef felt like a human being. Mr. Geef was firmly convinced that a cold is nothing to be sneezed at.
...716 years ago, within the shadow of beautiful Mount Olympus in the land of ancient Greece, was born an institution known as the Olympic Games. Emblematic of these glorious athletic festivals is the torchbearer, who down through the ages has carried aloft the precious flame to the far corners of the earth. Rome, Egypt, India, China, through forests and trackless wastes, over mountains and sea, down to the present day. The ritual of the Olympiads demands that this heroic flame shall not become extinguished, but shall be kept burning at all costs, serving as a beacon whose unfailing light shall guide all athletes in fair play and clean sportsmanship, to give them courage and forever remind them of the brave and the strong whose nerves of steel and cool heads shall keep alive and preserve at any sacrifice this precious spark for posterity, that all mankind shall benefit by the light that never fails. The first Olympic event was foot racing. Therefore, let us briefly analyze the fundamental strides. First, the sprinter. Note the powerful piston-like action of the legs as compared to the long distance or space-devouring stride of the miler. And then that of the marathon runner, whose effortless, untiring stride carries him for amazing distances. And last, but not least, the walk. Perhaps one of the most graceful of all, exacting the perfect coordination of all the muscles of the body. Note the similarity of the walk to a dance. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. Hey, wait a shake. We're off the track. Track. One of the most spectacular of all track events is the hurdles. Ready, set, go! Nothing can compare to the ease and grace of the hurdles, the sheer beauty of motion. Pole vault. Beginning with a short run, the pole is planted in the pit. A swing up. Hold it. We are now at the apex of the vertical lift. Notice the position of the legs just coming into the jackknife. Observe the swing of the hips and the knee flexion as the legs progress into their arc preparatory to crossing the bar. Crossing the... You know, that reminds me of a poem by Tennyson, Crossing the Bar. Sunset and evening star, and one clear call for me, and may there be no moaning of the bar when I put out to sea. Don't you think that's a lovely thought? I do. All right, jump. Oh yes. From this position, the body arches itself in a graceful glide, clearing the crossbar and settling it gently into the sawdust below. Terrific muscular development, plus height, weight, and mental alertness. The hammer must be swung in a circle until terrific speed is attained. And last, but far from least, the decathlon, a group of 10 events arranged to test the athlete's stamina and power.
Back through the smoke of centuries, when Columbus first set foot on the New World.
Ow!
How?
You?
Smoke.
Match?
Match.
Ah. And so Columbus not only proved the world was round, but also firm and fully packed. Smoking became a new habit in the old world.
Squire? Fire!
Yes, sire.
It got so man could face any test with a cigarette in his mouth. Ready? Aim! Fire!
It's a Phyllis Morrison.
Smokers could read the handwriting on the wall. Today, they see the skywriting in the air. The average man's habit of smoking leaves its marks deeply imprinted upon his surroundings. With tobacco, the smoker finds relaxation and contentment. A constant companion in his leisure hours. Ah, that last puff before retiring. And that first drag on arising. Ah, its mild fragrance with a morning shave. Ah, that cool inhale with coffee and toast. A
fast exhale while leaving for work. The soothing fag to face the day's toil. But sometimes, because of the irritated eyes, tickling throat, dry hack, coughing, wheezing, and the shortness of wind, the inveterate smoker gets a strange desire to rid himself of the habit.
I quit! There! I feel better already.
Done it. I sure admire a guy that can quit smoking like you can. It ain't easy. If it was, I'd quit.
Quitting, giving up the habit, changed Geef's entire outlook.
Hey, George, I'm a father. Have a cigar.
Well, thanks.
Almost forgot. You quit smoking.
Yeah. What did I quit smoking for? I like smoking. I'm no quitter. Get a lot of pleasure smoking. I love smoking. It's my hobby. Smoke. Smoke!
And the little man wins a big cigar.
A fag, a pipe, nail, weed, rope, or chawer, cigar, or snuffer, or anything. Just anything.
Why, of course, my good man. Have a cigar.
Oh, thank you, sir.
Give the smoker enough rope, and he'll hang on to his habit.
Today, more than ever before, education is playing an important role in the teaching of children. The school has become a vital part of every community, drawing children from every walk of life.
Off to school, George.
Eager to take advantage of its opportunities. Emerging from their sheltered confines, slipping easily into the habits of the student. Coming from far and near, struggling toward an education. Whetting their appetites for knowledge. Forming friendships for the future. Childish energy lets nothing stand in its way. In their tiny hands, they hold the future. The person upon whose capable shoulders rests the responsibility for their education is that unsung hero, the teacher. He must be fair, honest, understanding, and intelligent. He must handle every situation with the utmost dignity. With a complete understanding of his pupils, the experienced teacher equips himself for the classroom.
Pupils, Eddie,
here.
Mike,
here.
Tim,
here.
Norma,
here.
Janice,
here.
Winston,
present.
Marjorie,
here.
John,
here.
Lucille, George. Homework, children. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 14, 15, 16, 17. Who's absent? George, desist! a geography lesson. Now, children, we will study the effect history has played on geography. According to today's paper, the boundaries of Thailand, or Siam, but in your book is French Indochina, whereas Persia, now called, well, Mesopotamia. That's not far from the Afghanistan bordered by northern India. That's Pakistan, Pakistan. At the same time, however,
The students eagerly return to the classroom.
Spelling time. George, how do you spell the word cat?
Cat. K-A-T. Cat.
Wrong.
Youthful minds are encouraged to develop their latent talents. Ah, yes, the creative outlets of the arts and the crafts. Tests and examinations fill out the day as bright little minds gather knowledge from their teacher. But little hands make the time pass quickly. Contrary to popular belief, the teacher's work is not through at the end of the school day. Oh, no. There are many unfinished chores, blackboards to be cleaned, erasers dusted, and of course, the ever-present parent-teacher relationship.
Hey, what's the matter with my kid's grammar?
So, it is to this great profession and its halls of learning that we dedicate this. When the occasion arises, there are times when disciplinary action must be taken.
the earliest dawn of humanity, the cold, unrelenting law of nature has been and still is the survival of the fittest. Down through the ages, self-preservation was recognized as the first law of nature. Quiet! The headlong rush of time through several millennia found civilization creeping in, and man's eyes were opened to the possibilities of the use of his hands in self-defense. Time sped on in his endless journey for a few more thousand years to the medieval period, when man made use of armor as a means of self-protection.
Okay, that's your cue, boys.
Time lurches on a few more centuries. Then came the Romantic Age, when chivalry and fair play were introduced. Man has now become a gentleman. A couple of hundred years roll by, and we see man engaged in a crude form of fisticuffs. But due to the utter lack of science, these men could fight for only 75 or 80 rounds. Era. Then science steps into the picture in the person of the modern pugilist. Boxing has now become something more than just a show of brute strength. The modern fighter is the personification of skill and science, an example of brain over brawn.
No. We will start at the beginning. Scientific conditioning. First, we learn how to breathe properly. Inhale, exhale. Inhale, exhale. Inhale. A word should be said of the functions of respiration. With proper inhalation, the molecules of the atmosphere come in contact with the pulmonary cells of the thorax, and the lungs are abundantly supplied with clean, pure, life-giving oxygen.
Exhale!
There is no better conditioner than rope skipping. Punching the bag is an exact science, an art in itself. It develops a quick eye and agility measured in split seconds. Develop skill in covering up. And now, shadow boxing, where form and timing are studied and perfected. The shadow can become a real adversary. Hey, you. No, not you. The other fellow. Yes, you. Step up here. Before two opponents pit their skill, the ethics of the ring require a friendly handshake as evidence of true sportsmanship. All right, boys. Now let's demonstrate a few of the more common blows. First, the right cross, then the left cross. And the double cross. Only the magic of the slow motion camera can show the scientific delivery of the uppercut. With all the grace and rhythm of a ballet dancer, the opponent ducks under the guard. Now the wind-up, the blow. Notice how balance is maintained, how the follow-through leaves the boxer in a perfect position to protect himself from a counter-blow. Now, in the interest of science, let's try this again at normal speed. Hold it. Now notice the course of this blow. The entire weight of the body is brought into play to land with terrific force, flush upon the button. All right. don't forget to duck. Now a series of miscellaneous blows. Left jab, bolo, rabbit, solar plexus, backhand, and roundhouse. Oh, foul! There's a positive rule that no fighter shall ever hit below the belt. It is unsportsmanlike, unethical, unnecessary, and uncomfortable. And finally, the big night. 100,000 hearts beat quicker. A mighty cheer shakes the rafters. What a physique! What confidence! Science has produced at last the perfect fighting machine. Upon fishermen's luck. For today, fishing has become a truly fascinating science. When to fish can be determined by the astrological signs of the zodiac, whose countless stars and planets control all the tides of the Earth's waters. Hence, when Neptune enters the constellation of Piscis, or fishes, the cosmic vibrations create in the fish an uncontrollable desire to bite. When the Earth enters this celestial orbit, it too falls under the powerful influence of these vibrations. Now, let us observe the effect of this phenomena on man. Dormant within his bosom slumbers an inert instinct to fish. This desire becomes acute only through bodily contact with the cosmic undulations of Piscis, or fishes. This creates a mental malady known as fishes febris, or fishing fever. During this trance-like period, the angler checks his fishing tackle and succumbs to an overwhelming desire to test his casting skill. A deft flick of the wrist, whip of the pole, the tug of the line, and the angler can easily imagine a fighting fish in a crystal pool. Where to fish? Ah, the beauty of the sunrise or the high rugged mountains. The freshness of the early morning dew. The joy of sleeping in the great out-of-doors. The fisherman awakens at the crack of dawn, deeply impressed with this closeness to nature. Ah, to breathe deeply of that pure, rarefied mountain air. The trout. The mountain trout is an alert, intelligent creature. A fighter of the first water, rugged, strong, daring. His dauntless fortitude makes him absolutely fearless. How to approach the stream.
Slip up quietly to a shrub or bush, and don't let the fish see you coming.
Now you've done it. Once the pool is disturbed, the fish can never be enticed to bite. Fly fishing. The fly fisherman must know how his tackle and other objects appear to the fish. Therefore, through the eyes of the fish, we view the angler, the tempting fly, and study carefully the reaction of the fish. The lure is scientifically designed. When dropped into the water, the resulting optical illusion creates a very realistic effect. Select a spot free from overhanging brush and limb. Swing the arm with a liquid rhythmical motion. Straight as an arrow, the lure spins over the water to land lightly into that deep purple pool. Sings and the poor fish is really hooked. Lake fishing, immortalized in the words of the ancient bard. Quote, upon yon lake's calm, placid breast, the angler plies his yaw to tempt a smile from Lady Luck, where'er his hook may fall. Unquote.
Oh, a strike! A strike! Oh, boy, what a whopper! Look at that pull, Ben! Hear that reel, Sam! Don't give any slack! Play him! Play him! Keep cool now, don't get excited! Here he comes! There he goes! What a whack! Keep cool! Use your head, man! Use your head! Keep your eye on him! Wow! Look at him go! Brace yourself. Ah, we landed him. Watch it now, watch it, watch it. Don't let him get back in the water.
Truly, no pride is so justifiable as that of a successful fisherman.
Ladies and gentlemen, here we are out at the Elite Deluxe Sports Palace about to witness one of the biggest ice hockey games of the season, bringing together two of the top-ranking teams in the league. In no other game is the feeling of competition so keen, affecting both players and spectators alike, turning casual friends into bitter enemies. Tonight's game looks like a sellout. A capacity crowd of thousands of rabid sports-loving hockey fans has turned out to cheer for their favorite teams. Yes, sir, the stands are filling up. They're really packing them in. Well, it seems there have been a few last-minute changes in the starting lineups. Get your pencils ready. Now, instead of Hannah at left wing, Stallings will start. Put DeGrady in face of Williams at center, then Berg over Aliquist, and at left defense, McCormick replaces Dunham. At goal, Angham takes the place of Nichols, and, oh yes, the teams will be the Loose Leafs versus the Anteaters instead of the Moose and Pelicans. All right, the teams are skating out onto the ice. Listen to that ovation. And here come the two stars of their teams, Icebox Bertino and Fearless Ferguson. A heated rivalry has developed between these two boys. Both are tied for the top league scoring honors, and tonight's game will be the payoff. As these boys go, so go their clubs. The referee for tonight will be that popular arbiter, Clean Game Kinney. A favorite of the fans. The entire responsibility of the game rests squarely on the shoulders of the referee. This keen-eyed individual must follow the course of play so closely that sometimes it seems he must have eyes in the back of his head. Uh-oh, a penalty. There go the guilty players into the penalty box. With these stars out, the complexion of the entire game may be changed. A hush of expectancy settles over the crowd as the teams line up for the face-off. The referee drops the puck, and the game is on! There's the puck over the blue line, passed out to the right wing, checked by the opposing left wing, who passes the puck back to the right defense, cutting in fast, picking the puck off the boards, now back to the left wing, and pivots around the center. There's a scramble for Bethanian. Boots has got it. He's down the ice, tries for a shot at the net, but the goalie puts up a stout defense, knocking it away for a beautiful save. Here comes Colin DeGrady fighting for the puck. There's a shot, and he scores! No, no, no! Look at that stop! Nothing ever gets past that goalie. Berg moves it clear down the rink. It's taken by McCormick. McCormick to Papineau with the blue line. Over to Murray. Murray cutting over the Loose Leafs defense. He tries to draw the goalie out of position. There's a shot, and... Save, fellow.
Hooray! Hooray!
Hooray!
What am I saying?
Puck shoots out the center ice. Both teams are battling furiously for possession. Here come Bertino and Ferguson out of the penalty box. And there go Bertino and Ferguson back into the penalty box. The Loose Leafs take the play away. Kyle takes a pass on the right wing. Center ice. Oh, Riley shanks the puck and a beautiful poke check at the end. There's a long pass ring wide and a scramble for the puck. A little rough play out there. Both sides are trying to score. And there's the buzzer ending the first period. In order to give the cash customers a chance to sit in their seats, there are 10-minute rests between periods. Starting the second stanza. The team takes to the ice. Puck is faced off. There's a pass out to the side. The Loose Leafs come up with a play. Here comes McCormick cutting down the side. That boy's sure burning up the ice. Spinning like a top, he crosses the blue line. The defense closes in. Wow! They really laid it into him. Come Bertino and Ferguson out of the penalty box. And there go Bertino and Ferguson back into the penalty box. There's a pass out to Bond, and here he comes swinging wide with a blinding burst of speed. Next up is Bond, sliced his way through. Cup cuts him fast, picks up the puck, takes a shot at the net, and the goalie kicks it away. There's another shot, and another. The goalie has the situation well in hand. No, no! He nuts the old net for a score, a score, a score, a score, a score! Anteaters one, Loose Leafs nothing. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that score might be enough to put the game on ice. They line up for the face-off. There's a scramble. The puck is boarded against the side. Here come Bertino and Ferguson out of the penalty box. And there go Bertino and Ferguson back into the penalty box. coming up to the blue line is... Boom! He's right down the crease trying to knock the count. And the goalie boots it away for a back to the save. And the crowd loses its mind. Here's the play. Mohawk poke checks it away from Williams. Intercepted by Shaw. Pass behind to Alec Wilson. Swift it to Pete. And there goes right down the middle. He shoots. The referee's in the way. There's another nice save at the net. He clears the puck toward the front, but it's too hot to handle. Now both teams are fighting it out on the ice. This is anybody's game. Riley shoots, McCormick shoots, Berg shoots, Pugley shoots, Weaver shoots, DeGrady shoots, Sepp shoots, Nolly shoots, Bushman shoots, Larkin shoots, everybody shoots. There's a score, and another, and another, and another. The goalies are standing their ground, but they've got their hands full. It's a three-scoring game. Shaw is shooting, Moore is shooting, Tobelman shoots, Lowry shoots, Clark shoots, Dolly shoots. The score is piling up. 27, 28, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30,
and the crowd loves it. And there's a right cross to the chin, and a left uppercut, and a high one to the center field stand. Oh, a foul, it's breathtaking, and they're messing it up. Wow, a basket, very fast, oh, touche! And look at that blocky, and look, look down the sidelines, and it's a touchdown. Strike, ball, ball, strike, ball, strike, he's out, out like a light. Here comes the pitch, it's a long, low drive, straight down the fairway. Is it a strike? Is it a strike? No, it's fair. Low bad news, low bad news, low bad news. Rally! Rally! Wow! Wow, what a performance! What a show! It's every man for himself! And that's why ice hockey is called a spectator sport.
Since the beginning of time, man has been possessed with the desire to have a roof over his head and a place to hang his hat.
Not me.
Constant reference to the blueprints is necessary in order to facilitate the building and fabrication of the many complex and minute items of structural simplicity. Craftsman must check and recheck with the spirit level. This accurate and sensitive instrument assures precision of construction. Setting the window glass or glazing, extreme care and delicate handling must be exercised at all times.
Oh,
painting adds a finishing touch to any house. Paint applied to reflect the owner's personality also covers a multitude of sins. Have been transformed by wood, metal, and masonry into solid reality. The happy homeowner is proud to extend the warmth and hospitality of his home.
You!
For he's a jolly good fellow. For he's a jolly good fellow. For he's a jolly good fellow.
There's no place like home.
Some ducks, I'm a going to hunt some ducks for my fair lady. And a deedle,
good morning.
Diddle dum, doodle dee, da diddle dum, hoodle dee, da diddle dum for my fair lady.
Oh boy, the skies are loaded with them. She works. Hey, where'd she go? Oh, there you are. Okay, Clementine, bring him in. Huh? Something wrong here. Somebody ain't telling the truth. Clementine? come back here.
Understand? Cause anybody knows them old kibbered wagons look powerful slow creaking and groaning across them plains. But let me tell you about one of them wagon trains that sought a speed record back in 48. Or was it 49? Ain't been busted yet. No siree. Not even by one of your dat blasted area planes. Now we were just leaving Nebraska, going into Florida. Hold on there. Weren't Florida? Were, Pennsylvania? Well, anyways, I was up ahead of scouting for engines on my old horse Hamlet. Called him Hamlet because he had a pretty bad case of stage fright. Well, we kept pushing west through New York, Buffalo, New York. When doggone my britches if and we ain't spotted by them there pesky redskins.
Bug!
No!
region in these whole United States gathered for a powwow. They were all of them there. A Blackfoot, an old Apache chief, yep, an old crazy horse, and a Cleveland Indian. Then come Big Chief Rain in the Face. Knocking them off like flies. And another engine bit the dust. They threw everything at us but the kitchen sink. All of a sudden, we had come out of ammunition. Our goose sure was cooked. We was goners, dead ducks, wiped out, massacred. Hey, wait a minute. Whoa, hold on there. Why, just when we was about to give up, along come a tornado. A twisting and a turning and a swallowing up everything. Just like one of them newfangled vacuum cleaners. Swallowed up every last one of them. Wagons and all. Well, partner, that old tornado just took us across them plains and mountains quicker than you could say Jack Robinson. Some of us settled in Oregon and Nevada and in California, and some of us went a little too far west. So long, strangers. Don't take no wooden engines.
Ha ha ha! When the day's toil is over, are you the type person who drags his weary body home, slumps into a chair feeling beat, bored, bushed, and listless? If so, you need a hobby. Take your pick. Pick. Picture. That's it. Photography. For the beginner, a few minor bits of equipment are necessary. Meters, photo floods, tripods, reducer, enlarger, printer, developer, hypo, paper, cutter, trimmer, buckets, pans, water, bulbs, lights, gloves, boots, trays, powder, reflectors, and camera. With these few inexpensive items, the ardent amateur photographer is ready to pursue his hobby. Once the equipment is properly placed about the darkroom, we are ready to load the camera with film. There are various types of film. Those most commonly used are roll film, film packs, and cut film. Is loaded correctly, we next pick the subject to be photographed. Perhaps one of the most fascinating is the filming of wildlife in its native habitat.
Something wrong here.
Oh,
And in conclusion, we often find a simple hobby is not only a source of great personal satisfaction, but also the happy means to financial independence.
To popular belief, golf is not a waste of time. The transforming of city dumps, vacant lots, and civic eyesores into beautiful greens and fairways more than justifies the existence of the game. Out in the green open fields where a man can get away from it all. Happily, the golfer chooses his club. The modern golfer comes standard equipped with a set of scientifically matched and balanced clubs. A tee is used to support the ball. The interlocking grip is extremely scientific. The club is held loosely betwixt the thumb and forefinger of the right hand. Place the left hand, palm open, facing away, then slide the right hand below the left. Now flex the thumb and close the palm while moving the index finger over the lower thumb. Once this grip is mastered, the golfer is in a position to hit the ball, which is the object of the game. The interlocking grip gives the golfer a virtually unbreakable hold on the club. This is a divot caused by an incorrect swing.
Four!
Now let us analyze the correct swing by reducing the figure to its simplest form. This diagrammatical figure clearly shows the symmetrical design created by the path of action. Note how the golfer completes the stroke with an easy, graceful follow-through. This isn't as easy as it looks. Perfect form requires delicate coordination of the hands, feet, arms, legs, elbows, nose, and mind. And, oh yes, always remember, keep your eye on the ball. The putt is the simplest of all strokes. The ball is simply hit from here to here. However, better golfers leave nothing to chance. They consider all the elements: wind velocity, humidity, rotation of the earth, time of day, temperature, drift indication, lay of the land, trajectory angle, longitude, latitude, and a bit of mental calculation. This routine completed, the putt can now be made with confidence. Missing a putt is very aggravating. The approach shot, or chip to the pin. A ball incorrectly hit is known as a hook, slice, flub, dub, or something which causes the ball to curve in flight and usually results with the ball landing in the rough. The golden rule of golf is to play the ball where it lies. The golfer is sometimes tempted to remove his ball to a slightly better position.
This is strictly forbidden. Always play the ball where it lies.
Even in a sand trap, the golfer must obey that ironclad rule to play the ball where it lies. This may prove a bit trying at times, but that is why golf is known as the character-building game. To lose one's temper on the golf links denotes a weakness of willpower. Golf develops a man's best qualities. He learns restraint, poise, dignity, and self-reliance. Always play the ball where it lies. Playing the ball where it lies becomes an obsession. Come at last to the 19th hole, where we join our friends in the proverbial bull session that ends a perfect day of golf.
Beginning, the world was all wet. Today, it is still 4/5 wet. Man, the nomad, in the course of his migrations, often encountered bodies of water too wide or too deep to be crossed. Always the thinker, man soon evolved the most primitive form of aquatic transportation. A log. Supported by the log, or seated upon it, the next question was one of propulsion. First the foot, then the hand. And then, aha, the first marine invention, the paddle. From the paddle, the logical development was the oar, which employed the simple mechanics of the lever and fulcrum, producing maximum power with a minimum of effort. Because of the limitless, uncharted expanse of water, the ancient mariner oft-times found himself far, far out at sea, with only the stars to guide him.
Star light, star bright. Gosh, I wish I knew where I was tonight.
Swiftly and surely, the stars steered him on to his destination.
In the 13th century, even as today, great thinkers worried about what shape the world was in. Some great minds firmly believed that if you sailed west far enough, you would sail off the edge of the world. From the earliest days, sailors were preyed upon by pirates! In those romantic days, ships often changed captains very suddenly. This colorful ceremony is called walking the plank, or feeding the sharks.
Eight bells! Come and get it!
When old Father Neptune went on the rampage, for safety's sake, sailors would lash themselves to the mast. Thus, the sailor was able to stick to his post through hail and high water. The flag is the sign language of the sea. Sailors could communicate with each other by semaphoring and wiggy-wagging. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T, O, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T, O, E, F, G. He wigged when he should have wagged. The happy, carefree sailor expressed himself with the hornpipe, traditional dance of the sea. Hauling in rope, hoisting sail, rowing, look out, look out! Ah, the clipper ship. The queen of the seven seas. The heyday of sail. Iron men. Wooden ships. Through centuries of practice, the sailor has developed the perfect set of sea legs. A sailor is easily recognized by his walk. Oh, knots. Who should know how to tie knots better than a sailor? He invented them. The square knot, the sheep shank, the granny knot. A very interesting knot. Bears great strain. The slip knot. Now the barrel knot. Most slip-proof of all.
Take it away!
This explains why sailors are often called old tars. And now, through trial and error, the sailor has at last mastered the sea. A far cry, indeed, from his early ancestors to the modern scientific mariner of today.
All hands, man battle stations, stand by to attack.
Hey! Stand by to attack!
Ready? Aim! Fire!
gliding today has developed into a sport that can be easily mastered by anyone with a desire to learn.
Yeah, nothing to it.
First, test the prevailing winds by means of the windsock. Then choose the proper terrain and make sure the takeoff is clear of all obstacles, particularly trees and telephone poles.
Die, die, dum, die, dee, die. Here goes my glider and I, bye, bye.
Turn into the wind, wind up, test your equipment and take off! Faster, faster! More speed, more speed! We did not attain sufficient altitude.
Gosh.
Now, the towing method. With a rope attached to the nose, the glider should be pulled rapidly along until it has attained the necessary speed to carry it into the air, somewhat in the manner of flying a kite.
Oh, high, high, over the trees we'll float.
Don't let minor mishaps dampen your spirits. Keep cool and try more speed. Now, launching the glider by mechanical means. Greater speed can be attained by this method. However, this system can become involved.
Hey, come back here! Wait for me!
Should an unforeseen emergency arise, never allow the craft to get out of hand. Whatever happens, don't give up the ship. This method having proved somewhat unsuccessful, let us scan the book for a better method. The catapult is one of the most ingenious and scientific devices used in aerodynamics to project the craft with the speed of a bullet into the stratosphere.
Oh, high, high, yep, we'll fly high. I'm brave, but I'm careful.
To open parachute, jump, count 10, and pull the string.
Okay. Count to 10 and pull string. Yeah. Count to 10, pull string. Count to 10, pull string. Count to 10 and pull string. I made it! I made it!
Yes, the catapult has the advantage of gaining altitude immediately. I'm glad this came up. Now don't forget to count 10 and pull a string.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Pull.
We will take up how to land at a later date.
I am the sky like the bird. Why?
Well, here we go again. And now, the thrill that only birds can know. The sky above, the earth below.
Die, high up we fly like the birds in the sky. Like the birds in the sky. Like the birds. Birds.
Something wrong here.
Foregoing methods fail through some unforeseen quirk of fate, then use your own ideas. For after all, launching a glider is really very easy. Just remember these simple fundamental facts. One, the initial impetus. Two, the low and high aspect ratio. Three, control of equilibrium. Four, theory of convection currents. Five, the principles of abstract aerostatics, and so forth, and so on, etc., etc. Truly, you can't keep a good man down.
Sing!
High, high, up in the sky.